Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of the Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee in 2019. I welcome Liz Smith MSP who is attending the meeting this morning. Can I ask everyone in the public gallery to please switch off their electronic devices or turn them to silent so they don't affect the committee's work. Item number one is decision on taking business in private. Do members agree to take item three in private this morning? Thank you. Item two is the Section 22 report, the 2017-18 audit of NHS Tayside. And I'd like to welcome our witnesses to the meeting this morning. John Brown, Chairman of NHS Tayside, Malcolm Wright, former Chief Executive of NHS Tayside, Alan Gray, Director of Finance, Dr. Annie Ingram, Strategic Director of Workforce, and Hazel Craik, who's Head of Employment at the Central Legal Office. I'd now like to invite John Brown, Chairman, to make a brief opening statement.
Thanks very much, Convener. Firstly, I'd like to thank the committee for this opportunity to respond to the Auditor General's report on the 17-18 audit of NHS Tayside. I'd also like to thank the Convener for agreeing for our Finance Director and Workforce Director to attend to assist the Chief Executive and me to give you assurance in the progress that we're making to stabilise our financial position and to develop the capability and capacity to deliver the service changes that are required in Tayside to improve our performance and to achieve financial sustainability in the longer term. Introducing Hazel Craig from the Central Legal Office, and Hazel's been the Principal Advisor to the Board in the handling of the departure of the former Chief Executive. And I realise that the departure of the former Chief Executive has been a matter of concern for the committee, and myself and my colleagues will do our utmost to respond to those concerns as fully as possible today. Hopefully, the Audit General's report and the report that you received from the Advising Assurance Group, plus the written submission that the NHS Tayside sent in last week, I'll give the committee a good insight, not only into the 17-18 audit, but also the work of the interim leadership team since we took over in 2018. So I'd just like to quickly say a few words to summarise what we believe the situation in Tayside is as we speak today. But before I do that, I think it would be right to put on record that the board fully accepts the audit report as an accurate description of the 17-18 financial position and the performance that was delivered by NHS Tayside up to March 2018. And I'd also want to say up front that while we note that the Auditor General has acknowledged the agreement that NHS Tayside reached with the former Chief Executive as reasonable, we do accept that mistakes were made. And I want to apologise for those errors. I can confirm that the Remuneration Committee has met and endorsed the decision to change the former Chief Executive's notice period and that the overpayment of funds to the NHS Scotland pension scheme have now been returned to NHS Tayside. Of course, the biggest challenge faced by the interim leadership team wasn't the handling of departure of the former Chief Executive. It was bringing financial stability to NHS Tayside and developing the plans to deliver service changes that are required to bring Tayside into financial balance. And of course, that's at the same time as improving performance. And I'm sure we'll touch on all of those issues as we go through the papers this morning. The committee will note from the papers that we believe that financial position has actually stabilised in Tayside and that the challenge we now face is delivering the changes required to improve that position. We need to improve access to our services. We need to improve our mental health services in particular. We need to integrate the health and social care at a bit more pace. And we need to develop the workforce required to support this. But then again, these are challenges that we share with all the boards across Scotland. As the Auditor General has acknowledged, as has the Advisory and Assurance Group, so far as an interim leadership team, we've done a lot of work to understand the provision and costs of services within Tayside, and we're now turning that work into action plans for change. That's our priority. And the February board will review the progress that the leadership team has made towards delivering our plans, not only for next year, but for the next 3 years. This, of course, this level of change won't happen overnight. There's a long history of problems within TESA going back 6 years. So I think for us realistically to be aiming to be in financial balance and having our performance improved over the next 3 years is a realistic ambition for us. And finally, I just want to put on record my own appreciation for all the hard work and commitment that's gone into taking TESA forward from the interim chief executive, Malcolm on my right here, and the rest of the interim leadership team, and in particular all the staff across NHS TESA who have worked so hard in the last 9 months to turn things around. And I'd like to include a special mention in that to the clinicians who have played a real crucial role in redesigning our services and getting involved in that. And it'd be remiss of me not to mention our colleagues in NHS Grampian and in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde who have supported Malcolm and myself, Annie and Alan, as we have had responsibilities across the two boards, and without their support, we couldn't have delivered on that. So, thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brown. I'm going to open questioning for the committee this morning, and I'd like to start with the issue of the payment to the former chief executive. I think if we can try and take some questions on that and get some clarity, that would be useful. It's this committee's job to follow the public pound. We sit here on behalf of the public to scrutinise public spending and the effective use of their taxes. This committee has been very clear in its view for a number of years now, predating my convenorship, that we're very concerned about golden handshakes and large severance payments in the public sector. And during our scrutiny, both the previous Section 22 report on NHS Tayside and this, I think this committee said on the record probably no less than six times that we didn't want to see enhanced severance payments or golden handshakes to any members of management in NHS Tayside. But we find ourselves back here today with the Auditor General's report in front of us. And that's exactly what has happened. Now, we have the information both from the Auditor General's report and from other documents that give us a bit of insight as to what actually has happened here. And our understanding, and I think yours as well, is that there was a payment made in lieu of notice, which the former chief executive had in a contract that was 3 months, but it seems to have been increased to 6 months. I want to ask witnesses how and why that happened.
I think probably the best person to talk us through the process, how we came to that decision, that it was appropriate for the notice period to be extended from 3 months to 6 months, is the accountable officer on my right here. So I'm going to hand over to Malcolm.
Malcolm Wright.
Yeah, thank you very much, convener. Do I need to press? No. Thank you very much, convener. I would want to straight up acknowledge what the Auditor General has said. And reading the words of the Auditor General in her report and also her evidence that she led at the last committee meeting where this was discussed. And I think the key point here was about, do we seek to negotiate a settlement or do we not? And I think the Auditor General has agreed with the view that actually seeking to negotiate a settlement was a reasonable decision to make. As accountable officer, I need to balance risk and achieve the best value I possibly can for the public purse. So in terms of the advice that I received, which I, you know, believe to be correct, and I've examined this carefully, there are a level of risks facing the board that would have ended up costing significantly in excess of the amount of money that was eventually paid out, which was in the order of £32,000. So, and I'd be very happy to go into some of the detail about the background of that. So I think the first point is that actually negotiating a settlement, I think, was a reasonable decision to take. And the Auditor General has also said that given the balance of the risks facing the board, to have agreed a settlement period of 6 months would not have been unreasonable. So, you know, in terms of the order of the settlement that's made, given the balance of risks that the board faced and the real risk that there was going to be a level of public expenditure in terms of running, defending potential claims against the board, they were of an order that was significantly greater than what was actually settled for. I'd also want to concur with what the Auditor General said, that there was a fundamental misunderstanding within the board that 6 months was the standard notice period and that the notice period could be increased without going to the Remuneration Committee. That was a misunderstanding. It was an error, and as accountable officer, I apologise to the committee for that taking place.
Just to clarify, are you telling the committee that you were aware that the contractual entitlement was 3 months and you increased it to 6 months as part of the settlement agreement?
That is correct. Okay. And that was part of the negotiation with the solicitors for the former chief executive, and Hazel Craig can add to this in terms of what the outcome was going to be.
So is it normal practice to change contractual entitlements when you are negotiating a settlement agreement?
Well, maybe ask Hazel Craig to comment on that. But the point I'm making, convener, is that seeking to make a set of decisions on the basis of risk and to minimise additional expenditure to the public purse, and that an eventual settlement in the order of £32,000 was significantly less than what we would have had to have paid out in different ways if legal claims were.
So it wasn't a mistake. It was an intentional decision on the part of the board to change the former chief executive's contractual entitlement from 3 months to 6 months. Is that correct?
That is correct. And there was a fundamental misunderstanding. And just to be clear to the committee, there was a misunderstanding that actually 6 months was the standard notice period of chief executives. And that goes back to a circular that was written back in 2006 that laid out a standard notice period for chief executives. That circular was never actually issued, and the final circular that was issued said that it was between 3 and 6 months, and anything over than 3 months needed to be approved by the Remuneration Committee.
So let me understand. You wanted to settle. You looked at the contract. You saw it was 3 months, and you thought, well, actually, other chief executives in Scotland have 6 months in their contract, so we'll increase it to six.
No, it wasn't as straightforward as that. And I'll maybe bring
Hazel Craig.
In terms of the legal discussions that took place.
Excuse me. So I became involved in advising in relation to this matter at around the time that the board was progressing with dealing with the process that might have led to termination of the contract. At that point, there was communication from these solicitors of the former chief executive. It was clear that there wasn't going to be cooperation with that process. Various potential legal challenges were mentioned as a possibility. There was a discussion about how that letter would be responded to. And one of the decisions that was made was that there would be a telephone call made to the solicitors for the former chief executive.
Could you move to the point about the 3 and 6 months? I realise there's probably a lot of background, but we need to use the committee's time efficiently this morning.
As part of that conversation between solicitors, which obviously I'm not at liberty to discuss,
of course,
one of the issues which was raised was a six-month notice period, and an understanding that that was the norm for chief executives. That was fed back to the board, and decisions were taken thereafter to conclude a settlement agreement on that basis.
Okay, I'm not sure I completely follow. So you were aware, as the legal advisor to NHS Tayside, that the contract stated 3 months, but you advised that because other chief executives in Scotland had 6 months, it would be okay for that entitlement to be increased. Is that correct?
excuse me, not entirely. I was aware that the contract stated that it was 3 months. I was aware that there were various challenges being made by the solicitors for the former chief executive. There was a discussion. One of the solutions that was proposed to go forward to negotiations was a six-month notice period. That was a matter that I took back to the board. There was discussion about that, and a decision was made, having weighed up the risks, that it was a reasonable way forward to conclude a settlement agreement on the basis of a six-month notice period.
Okay, so I think I understand that the position that NHS Tayside took was that the contractual entitlement, you were clear, was 3 months, but it was decided to increase it to six as part of that settlement agreement, and you took advice from lawyers, and that's the decision that you came to. I have another couple of points of confusion around this, though, because John Brown, you've been chairman, you've been involved in NHS boards for many, many years, and you actually chair the Remuneration Committee at NHS Tayside. How was it that you didn't know that a variation in contract such as this needed to be passed by the Remuneration Committee?
The circular that was issued that made that a requirement was issued in 2006. I've been a chairman in the NHS for the last 3 years, so it predates me. I've never been in the circumstances where a chief executive was leaving the board in these sort of circumstances, so I was unaware it existed.
So you didn't know about
didn't
that rule? You didn't know
no.
that had to go past
no.
the Remuneration
had
Committee?
Had I known that rule existed, I would have taken it to the Remuneration Committee, and the Remuneration Committee would have considered it.
Okay.
When I was advised by Audit Scotland that this circular existed and this circular required it to go to the Remuneration Committee, I then took it to the Remuneration Committee. Remuneration Committee considers it and agreed that the decision to enter the negotiation was the right thing, and that it was a reasonable step to take, was to extend it.
Mr. Brown, you wrote me a letter which was copied to other members of Parliament in our region on the 7th of August last year, and you stated in that letter, all payments are legal and contractual entitlements, and no additional payments have or will be made by NHS Tayside. As of the 7th of August last year, that statement was not correct, was it?
It was correct, actually.
How could it be correct when you didn't get approval of the Remuneration Committee to vary the contract until November?
Because the contract settlement agreement, which I think you have had sight of, supersedes any previous contracts, and that was agreed and became legal and contractual on the 28th of June, which was prior to the former chief executive's resignation on the 31st of July. That's the legal advice that we have had on this.
Okay. Let me
and
ask
that
you.
Was the basis of the letter.
Okay.
I mean, the background to the letter clearly was that there was a great deal of concern following media reports that the former chief executive had received £300,000 of a payment, a severance payment, because of the requirement to protect personal information of the former chief executive. We were not in a position to put out the actual amount in the settlement into the public domain, but because of the concern that the Tayside public had, the concern that the Tayside staff had, I decided that we would give them some comfort by writing to this committee, having obviously part of the media coverage expressed that the committee would want to be involved in it. And the intention in that letter And the intention in copying that letter was to give the Tayside public and the Tayside staff the confidence that whatever payments were going to the former chief executive would be subject to scrutiny.
Yes, there was indeed a great deal of concern because there was a real lack of transparency around this exit, and the committee had been clear. And I don't think the public in Tayside were looking for a golden handshake for a former chief executive who had presided over severe financial mismanagement on the board. Let me ask you one final question on this. You put a submission into the committee for this morning's meeting, which was very helpful, but I was slightly concerned by some of the content of it, because you seem to be suggesting at paragraphs 2.10, 2.11, that the error that was made was not putting the change past the Remuneration Committee, rather than the error being the change to 3 to 6 months. Do you still stand by that?
Yes. I believe that it's a reasonable decision that was made by the accountable officer to enter into a negotiation, given the risks of the additional financial burden that would have come to the board of this situation progressing over a much longer period. I believe it was reasonable to bring the former chief executive in Tayside in line with the norm of the other territorial boards.
Do you think that's reasonable, though, Mr. Brown? Because as I just said, the former chief executive presided over a board that was in financial chaos, is now owed the Scottish Government £60 million, is way behind on all government's performance targets. So why? I don't think public in Dundee and the wider region of Tayside think that that would be reasonable. The increase that you put on this golden handshake is equivalent to a teacher in a Dundee primary school, that teacher's annual salary. So how is that a reasonable decision?
I think you have to balance the cost of going down that route against the cost of going down the alternative route. And the accountable officer and the board have responsibility towards a public purse of ensuring that public funds are spent in the best possible manner.
Okay, well, on that exact point of risk, my colleague Liam Kerr has some questions.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to go back to Mr. Wright, if I might, about this, because you have said at some length that there's a whole load of risk that has been mitigated as a result of taking these decisions. So as far as you're concerned, Mr. Wright, at the point that this decision was made, what were the nature of those risks? What was the claim that you felt NHS Tayside was going to be facing? And what was the value of that claim in your mind?
Yes, and some of that is outlined in the business case that went to the Scottish Government. And I know there has been criticism that there could have been more information in that business case. And I apologise for that. But let me just outline some of the risks that we were aware of. I mean, first of all, there had already been a delay in the process, in terms that the former chief executive had a period of medically certified sickness absence. So that had delayed possibility of formal proceedings actually starting it. Secondly, solicitors acting for the former chief executive had formally declined a request for the former chief executive to come into the board for a meeting to discuss her further future employment.
Can I just, if you'll forgive me, what was the claim, the Employment Tribunal claim, that you believed the NHS Tayside was facing, and what was the value of that claim when the board took the decision to sign off on this payment?
The value of the claim, and I'll ask Hazel Craig to come in on the details of the claim, but the value of the claim, with the costs of defending it, were in the region of £90,000 to £100,000 to £110,000. And if this had gone to an employment tribunal, and without any comment on the merits of whatever legal case might be brought, the value of a settlement that an employment tribunal can give, if it was for age, if it was for sex, the caps are lifted on that.
But so this is my point, Mr. Wright. Were you facing a claim for age or sex, or were you facing a claim for unfair dismissal and or constructive dismissal, which of course would be capped at significantly less than 90 to £110,000.
We were facing the prospect of claims, and again, I'll ask Hazel Craig to talk the committee through that.
Ms. Craig.
Thank you. Excuse me. Yes, what the board was facing was having started down the route to invite the chief executive in to explore the fact that accountable officer status had been removed and therefore that rendered her job impossible to perform. That put the board in a position where you're not in a normal process of a disciplinary process, for example, but you still need there to be a fair process to result in the dismissal of an employee. The board was progressing or hoping to progress down that route when it received correspondence from the solicitors for the former chief executive, in which they said that she would not be attending meetings in relation to that, suggesting that she felt she had been mistreated due to sex and age and raising other matters. So what the board, from my...
Yes. Offered to resign.
Did she offer to resign, not whilst I was dealing with the matter?
Mr. Wright?
Not that I'm not aware of her offering to resign. So, do you want to add to that?
Dr. Ingram, did you have any involvement in this?
Yes, I did. She did offer to resign at the beginning, on the 9th of April. I was asked to contact her solicitors, and at that time she offered to resign. She then, we then had communication through the CLO that her solicitors felt that she was unwell and unable to make an informed decision, and that's when she then went on to a period of sick leave. As Ms. Craik has said, after the letter which she's referred to, there was then the conversation from the solicitors with representatives from the CLO. The request was she would resign if the board would agree to 6 months' notice.
Interesting. I might come back to this because I just want to reflect on what you've just said, if I might.
Do I bring Alec Neil in and come back to you?
Sure.
Alec Neil.
Yeah. Can I just follow? Because the reason I'm asking is there's nothing we can really do in turning back the clock in this case. But it seems to me there's some systemic issues to be addressed. I mean, the fact that the chair of the Remuneration Committee wasn't advised by the full-time officers about the circular in 2006 is an example of a failure to support the chair, in my view, and it's an unacceptable failure. That's what full-time officers in the legal office and the finance departments and the audit departments are there for, is to advise non-executive directors about circulars that happened long before they took up position. Not just one small example of systemic failure here. Can I just probe a wee bit with Dr. Graham? You say that the chief executive offered to resign at the beginning of April. Could you give us a timeline of what happened thereafter? Did anybody accept a resignation? Was a resignation discussed by the board or with the minister? When did you then receive a subsequent letter, basically, it would appear, basically withdrawing the resignation unless she gets 6 months? What was the timeline of all of that? And what was the sequence of it?
Sorry, did you mean Dr. Ingram? You said Dr. Graham? Did you mean me?
Sorry.
The timeline was that the accountable officer status was removed on the 6th of April. On the 9th of
by
April...
By the Cabinet Secretary?
By Paul Gray.
Right, okay.
I assume with... I mean, that's a matter for Scottish Government colleagues. I was asked by my lead in Scottish Government to make contact with the solicitors with a view to seeing whether we could come to a settlement, whether she would resign, because that was where we thought it was going. As I've just said, I contacted the solicitors and initially there was an offer that she would resign. She then was unwell and her solicitor gave advice to our solicitors that it would not be appropriate for her to make a decision because her solicitor believed that she wasn't well enough and there was a medical certificate to confirm that.
So what was the time gap between the offer to resign and...
2 days.
2 days, right.
Yeah. She then was off sick for a long period of time.
Yeah.
And following that, there were discussions about whether or not we could find alternative employment for her. That was not possible.
Within the National Health Service or within,
The National within the National Health Service, but mainly within NHST side, because, as you know, we're independent employers.
Yeah.
Thereafter, the chair, as has been referred to, invited Ms. McLeay to come to a meeting on the 14th of June, and that meeting was to consider whether or not we would terminate her employment, and there was a board meeting set for the 28th of June, at which point we had a paper ready to go to the board requesting that we would terminate her employment. We were responded to on the 8th of June with a letter from the legal advisers, which indicated that she was not going to come to the meeting, as Ms. Craik has said. And thereafter, there was a conversation with her lawyers. At that point, she offered to resign if the board would consider 6 months' notice.
I mean, there's loads in there. First of all, a lot of this is absolutely new to this committee, which is also unacceptable, quite frankly. This is totally unacceptable. But just take two examples of what's been said. How many people who are porters in the National Health Service who are being sacked because of the lack of performance then got offered another job in the health service? I mean, it seems to me this is one of the things that really has always angered me about the health service. Jobs for the boys at the top and the people at the bottom are not treated in anything like the same level. I mean, why is somebody being offered alternative employment given the circumstances surrounding this and the history of what would appear to be financial mismanagement? Number one, that's one simple question. And also there's a question, I think, to Ms. Craig. And that is, and it goes back to the point Liam Kerr was making. A clear calculation was made that if this was allowed to go to an employment tribunal, you would lose the employment tribunal. But you're shaking your head saying no. In that case, why did you cave in? Why did you settle so quickly? I mean, this is public money you're dealing with.
Thank you for this opportunity to respond to that. Where there is a process ongoing, but parties become, there's a lack of engagement, and that's what we definitely had here. And we know, or I know from my experience of dealing with a lot of, not chief executives, but a lot of disputes with health service employees, that it often takes some time, weeks, months, for matters to move on. Because you do need a fair process at the end of the day to terminate somebody's employment. Yeah. So it can take a period of time. So that was one consideration, that we have an option that arrives that it's possible to conclude matters, and you have matters concluded at a particular date at a particular time. If you didn't do that, then you still need to pursue the process that you're pursuing, and it may be that that will take some time, and I think it would have taken some time to do that. In addition, so there is that risk that process takes some time, and that time costs money. The second risk is that the solicitors for the former chief executive had said that they had challenges that were in relation to sex discrimination and age discrimination, as well as the process that we were proposing to adopt for termination. It's correct, we don't know the detail of what those claims would have come to be. I see Mr. Kerr looking at me in relation to that.
Well, quite, because if I may, so at the point where presumably you signed off the business case, and I think, Mr. Wright, you had a figure in your mind that was presented to you, but you hadn't assessed what the claim might be. So I'm listening to it, I'm hearing there was a possibility of a resignation, so I'm thinking, okay, constructive dismissal, capped at 80-odd grand, but the business case has come forward. People have talked about discrimination to, okay, remove the cap, but you haven't assessed whether there was a discrimination claim there. Am I correct, Ms. Craik?
What we know is that there is a question raised by her solicitors, or not a question raised, a statement made, that she has concerns, that she thinks she has been unfairly treated due to sex and age. And she is questioning the process that we are going to adopt in relation to termination of employment. That raises in my mind the risk of three different types of claims being raised. One for sex, one for discrimination, one for age discrimination, one for unfair dismissal.
But with respect, Mr. Neil's point, I think, is your job, or the CLO's job, isn't it, is to assess the strength of those claims. Of course a claimant solicitor is going to say, I've got the strongest claim in the world, and therefore I'm going to win all this money. It isn't the job of the CLO to look at that, assess it, and say, well, actually, Mr. Wright, you know, this isn't the strongest claim ever. I don't think you're in the hole for north of £100,000. And actually, a much more sensible way to proceed would be something else.
The job of the CLO is to weigh up, you're right, the risks that there are, and the risk that I perceived there were to be, claims raised. That in itself would have to, it doesn't, whatever the merit of those claims, nonetheless, they would have to be, they would be defended. Time is taken defending claims, cost is incurred in doing that.
Completely the wrong message. You know, if what you're saying this morning is anybody, you know, who's vexatious, and there are very, very few of them in the health service, because the vast bulk of people in the health service are dedicated servants who don't behave in that kind of vexatious way. But the message you're sending out is anyone who wants to be vexatious, just cry foul. I was sacked because of my gender. I was sacked because I was late for my work. I was sacked unfairly. The CLO will settle and double my contract in the process in order not to have a scandal about a payment that wasn't. And this is absurd. Surely there must be a demonstration effect to people that says anyone who makes false claims, we will go to the tribunal, we will fight it. If we lose it, we lose it. But we are not going to be a soft touch. It's public money.
And
CLO fights in tribunal a number of claims every year which are thought to be without merit and for which there is thought to be a good reason to fight them. So CLO does not settle all claims that are raised. We can
and to be people below chief executive level. Clearly, in this case, you know, everybody was breaking their back to you know, is it a cover-up? I mean, was there any justification in your view from what you've seen to any claim? And I know this is, you know, obviously subjective in some way, but I mean, have you had any evidence that the reason why Ms. McLean lost her accounting officer status or was being effectively fired when that time came because of anything other than to do with the alleged incompetence around the financial mismanagement of NHS Tayside?
So I don't have the detail around that. What my view was...
You don't have the detail, and yet you made the decision not to pursue. I mean, surely one of the things you would have said is there any evidence, you know, is there any evidence of sex discrimination? Is there any evidence of age discrimination? Surely you must have asked that question before making the decision not to continue.
Well, firstly, it's not my decision to continue or not to continue.
Did you ask that question, Mrs. Craig?
I did not go back and ask for the details of that.
Why not?
So how could you assess the claim?
I wasn't assessing the claim. I was assessing the risk of a claim being raised.
But how can you assess the risk if the claim is about sex and age discrimination and you haven't even checked if there's a prima facie case for it?
Cases are raised... Often, from time to time, cases are raised which do have no merit. It doesn't stop those claims being raised. It doesn't stop money and time being spent defending those claims. What my view was that for the additional money that was being sought, it was a way of bringing certainty and conclusion to matters, and that the money which would be spent either getting to a termination of employment or to defending claims that would be raised was good value to do that, and I think that has been agreed by the auditor.
I don't see how you can, before reaching that decision, check some basic facts, such as is there any merit in the claim? If there's no merit in the claim, surely you should certainly give much more weight to the possibility of taking it to an employment tribunal and proving to people the NHS is not going to be a soft touch. You know, the money in the NHS, every penny is very valuable indeed. And if we send out this message, which is, you know, you just need to cry foul, and we won't even check if you've got any case against us, we'll just pay out and we'll change the rules retrospectively in order to make sure it doesn't appear as an extra gratia payment that you're not entitled to. That's what it was all about. It was covering up.
Not from my perspective.
But on that point, I mean, Mr. Neil makes a very valid point, it seems to me, because am I not right, Ms. Craig, that you signed off the business case?
No.
The CLO does not sign off the business case.
The CLO, so the business case is usually signed off, in fact, it's always signed off by one of the board members of staff. CLO is asked to put in figures at section 5 of the business case.
So the figures in section that were inserted in section 5 of the business case that Dr. Ingram puts to the board who sign it off were inserted by the CLO.
So what the CLO is asked to do is to put a figure in for what is the percentage risk of a claim being raised, and it puts in 50%.
Forgive me, it puts in as an automatic default 50%. Is that what you just said?
No, I said that that was the figure that was inserted. What it says in the business case is if you don't know for sure if a claim is going to be raised, then you should put in 50%. That's the Scottish Government guidance on that.
So the board... Forgive me, again, this is new information to me. The board, when it sees the business case, it sees 50% chance of losing,
no,
or 50% chance of winning?
No, it sees a 50% chance of a claim being raised.
But you'd inserted that not based on any information on the chances of a claim being made, but simply because the Scottish government says the guidance you give to the board, stick in 50% and they'll be good with that.
No, when a claim has not been, when there is a suggestion that a claim might be raised, but a claim has not at that point been raised, then the guidance is that you put in 50% as a likely chance of a claim being raised.
And does that apply, am I right that there's a section that says the estimated, the CLO's estimate of the chance of winning whatever case you've decided they've got? What's the figure that you put in there as standard?
I wouldn't say that there is a standard figure. The figure that was put in this case was 50%.
50%. And so you had assessed the claim, you had assessed whatever claims had been raised, so sex discrimination, age discrimination, and some form of unfair dismissal, I think you said. And you assessed the prospects, despite having just told Mr. Neil that they had not been sufficiently investigated, you assessed her chances of success at 50%.
The figure was put in as 50%.
Interesting. Just if I might move on, I think we're on the same point, but the submission at paragraph 2.10 says that the business case, which I think Dr. Ingram has prepared, doesn't refer to the notice period change. Can you help the committee understand how did that come about? How is this omission, because Dr. Ingram, you were talking about... there was a deal on the table, there was an offer to resign, and then perhaps later an offer to resign with some kind of payment. Isn't that material that the board should be fully aware of in terms of the notice change?
Everyone was fully aware of that, including Scottish Government. We had discussed the change to the notice period with the accountable officer, with the chairman, with colleagues in Scottish Government, and it was explicitly agreed.
But it wasn't in the business
case. Can I finish?
Case.
I must apologise to the committee for not making that explicit in the business case. I have certainly learned and will make sure I do it again. But by the time the business case was submitted, that was the contractual position because we had a legally binding agreement.
Just help me understand how that omission can take place, Dr. Ingram. That seems to be the most material aspect of this case, a notice period change, and yet at the point of sign-off, the people who sign off on it are not aware of it.
I'm sorry, they were aware of it.
But not in the business case?
They were aware of it. There had been full
discussion. But not in
the
business
case? As I've said, I've apologised for not writing it in the
business. Which is the document which mandates the payment. Is that correct?
I've answered your question.
One final question from me, if I may, convener, just on the pension, the reclaiming, and this is... So just for a bit of context, this is that an overpayment of the pension was made in accordance with the agreement that was concluded. but it was later found that that payment shouldn't have been made. And that money has now been brought back from that payment. But Ms. Craig, I believe there was some legal advice that said that it would breach the agreement to do that. But NHS Tayside has done it anyway, apparently in breach of your advice. So, Ms. Craig, do you maintain the position that the reclaiming of that overpayment of pension is a breach of the agreement that was concluded?
So the settlement agreement specified a sum that was to be paid over to the SPPA. Mm-hmm. That was not qualified in any way. And so it was my advice that that payment should be made. That payment was made. Mm-hmm. I advised that when the error was identified, whether it could immediately be should be immediately recouped, clawed back. I was saying that the agreement was unqualified and therefore it would not be in accordance with that agreement. I understand that since then, as part of the a reconciliation that happens on a, I'm not terribly sure, an annual basis, I think, it's been identified as an overpayment to the board, made by the board, and it has come back through that route.
So has it breached the agreement?
It's the money was paid in and it's come back as part of a reconciliation.
Has it breached the agreement?
A broader reconciliation.
You advised it would breach the agreement to do that.
Advised
has it breached
to claw
the agreement?
It back, to pay it in and then immediately claw it back would be a breach.
So there has been no breach of the agreement.
So I think that
advice.
If it has come back as a part of a broader reconciliation, then that's not the case.
Okay, we need to move on. I mean, I think what I would say is that I think we are agreed. I'm sorry, Mr. Byrne, we need to move on from this, but this is an utter guddle. And I think it is astonishing to the committee that we have HR expertise and legal expertise all at a high cost to the public purse, and we still end up in a position where a chief executive leaving the NHS is overpaid to such an extent. And I feel personally it's let down the people of NHS Tayside who we serve, but we need to move on. Anas Sarwar.
Thank you, Chair. I was going to turn to performance. Obviously, for as far as patients are concerned, they're cared about getting their treatment on time and getting adequate treatment and support. Do you recognise that the performance is simply not good enough in terms of treatment waiting times? I know there's a slight disparity in terms of the figures that we have from Audit Scotland and from the latest figures provided by NHS Tayside, but broadly, the figures indicate the same issues. Treatment time guarantee, target 100%, delivery 71%, 12-week first outpatient appointment, standard 95%, delivery 58%, cancer treatment percent standard 95%, delivery 79%, and the most shocking of all, actually, child and adolescent mental health services, patient to be seen within 18 weeks, standard 90%, delivery 39%, 6 out of 10 children not getting their mental health treatment in time. That's not good enough, is it?
With you entirely, Mr. Sarwar, it isn't good enough. I think the performance of the health board is of the major concern to the board and to everyone that works in NHS Tayside. That's why we have taken such a fundamental look at what the underlying problems are, how the organisation is structured, how it's funded, how it's resourced, and trying to develop from that analysis a programme of change which will deliver the services in a different way so that we can improve that access. We've also got additional funding from the Scottish Government. I think it's £2.74 million in recent weeks has come in from the Scottish Government to improve the waiting times in particular, including the CAMHS. I'll hand over to Chief Executive, perhaps give you a little bit more detail on some of the work around we've done specifically around waiting times, specifically around the cancer waiting times, specifically around CAMHS as well. But I do agree that the performance in NHS Tayside needs to be improved.
But before you do that, Mr. Byrne, just to emphasise the figures, we're not talking about a handful of individuals here.
No.
We're talking literally about thousands of people.
Yes.
In Tayside. So just one example, using NHS Tayside's own figures, at the end of September 2018, 10,414 people
were waiting longer than the 12-week waiting time target, over 10,000 people. And looking at the same figures around the 84 treatment time guarantee target at the end of September 2018, almost 3,000 people were waiting too long for that treatment. Again, I say that's simply not good enough, and there are literally thousands of people in Tayside that owe an apology.
I would like to apologise to the people of Tayside that haven't received the treatment within the treatment time guarantee. I would also like to reassure them that the Health Board has recovery plans in place. We have the additional funding coming in to resource those recovery plans so that we can make the improvement. I'd also like to reassure the public in Tayside that the Board is closely monitoring the situation through our Performance and Resources Committee and through the main Board. So we do have a recovery plan. We do have a trajectory that's been set for the recovery, and we are monitoring that. We have governance in place within the executive team where they're very much hands-on on a weekly basis looking at these figures and trying to improve them. There is no suggestion, I think, anyone could make that we are accepting this situation and not doing our utmost to change it. But I'll hand over to Mr. Wright.
Yeah, can I just add to that? I mean, I very much agree that a number of aspects of performance and NHS Tayside are not good enough. I think there's a number of aspects of performance where performance is good, you know, particularly around our emergency medicine department, that continues to perform well. But as you rightly say, the child and adolescent mental health, which is amongst the lowest in Scotland, is simply not good enough. The board has taken proactive action to call in help in terms of redesign of the CAM services. We're working closely with Dame Denise Coyer and her review of CAM services and the neurodevelopmental pathway for children that has been actively redesigned so that that can free up space for our children who need the more acute CAM services to be able to come through. So there's a range of performance areas where we've sought external help and we're looking to improve. And the figures, the latest figures I've seen in terms of the end of November, we're starting to see some improvements there. I think the money that we've managed to get from the Scottish Government under the Waiting Times Improvement Programme will help that as well. But you're absolutely right, we've got a lot of work to do on performance. And I'd like to add a couple of other things, but maybe take your next question as well.
So I'll come back to Camden in a moment, Mr. Wright. But what is the balance between, so the failure to deliver the treatment standards as expected, what's the balance between a failure of leadership and governance, a failure of adequate resourcing in terms of money, you mentioned the new money that's come through, and between workforce issues? Surely there's bigger issues in certain parts of that.
I think a number of these issues are connected. I think what the chairman and I have been seeking to do over the last 9 months is to really tackle some of the underlying systemic issues facing the NHS in Tayside. So one of the, I think, the major things that we've put in place is a clinically led system of management and leadership. So within the whole of the acute sector, for example, we've now got a new clinical leadership structure in place that is led by a senior clinician, supported by a senior nurse, and supported by management. So the mantra of clinically led, managerially enabled. And I think Sir Lewis Ritchie's report points to this about the clinical care groups, the devolution of budgets, putting clinicians in the driving seat supported by management. We're starting to see a number of improvements from a clinically led organisation. So those issues of finance, best use of workforce, getting the best outcomes for the population at Tayside, they're all linked. And I think there's a number of those indicators that are starting to move in a positive direction.
People will be interested to know what makes Tayside particularly challenging in certain issues, CAMS being the perfect example of that. Where would you put that? So I accept that leadership is a challenge, I accept that finances and resources are a challenge, and I accept workforce is a challenge. But specifically in Tayside, where would you put them in order of which are the greatest challenges in terms of those three?
I think some of the workforce issues are particularly challenging, but I do think the importance of clinical leadership, involving staff, involving patients, particularly around CAM services, which are one of the highest priorities for the board right now. So I think the systemic changes that the chairman and I have sought to introduce. And the chairman, I think we've put a paper with the committee's papers around the governance changes and the changes to the board, to the committees of the board, to the levels of scrutiny that we've got, the changes that I've made in terms of the senior management system. So actually appointing a head of performance management for the whole system that was not in place before. Actually, you know, appointing a head of planning and transformation to do the transforming Tayside work, getting in senior HR advice, I think Alan Gray's role in terms of stabilising the finances, all of these things are interconnected. And I think once we get the fundamentals in place, we're now starting to see some of those changes.
I accept all of that, Mr. Wright, but a lot of that will mean nothing to patients in Tayside who will still just feel as if they're not getting the standard of service that they're entitled to. Specifically on mental health services. Now, Tayside's mental health services have had huge attention in the last year in terms of from within this parliament, outside this parliament, and particularly in Dundee. Given how high profile the issues have been around mental health services in Tayside, given the campaign work that has been done, for example, by the Lost Souls of Dundee group, and given that we now do have an inquiry into mental health services in Tayside, how is it even fathomable that we have a situation where, despite all that attention, despite all that hard work, despite all that reassurance we've given to families, that we still have only 39% of CAMHS referrals being seen in time? How, I just can't understand that.
Yes, I mean, we're starting to see those numbers improving, but you're absolutely right. That 39% figure is not acceptable and it needs to continue to improve. What I can say is that we've got the systems and processes in place about the clinical leadership, the managerial support, the improvement support that we've got in from outside, the redesign of the services, and we're now starting to see some of the benefits of that coming through. But you're absolutely right. You know, in terms of the performance of the board and the impact on the population of NHS Tayside, my proposition is that unless we get the fundamentals, the systemic changes in place, which I think we've now got in place, that's the key.
Do you know how many people have lost their lives while waiting for mental health service referral treatment?
Off the top of my head, I don't know that number, but I know that there is significant, you know, morbidity and distress within the community about the ability to access mental health services.
Can you accumulate that figure and provide it to this committee?
We can try and get a figure for you. I'd be happy to do that. I think the point about the setting up of the independent inquiry under David Strang's leadership, I think was a sign by the board that we take mental health services extremely seriously.
And will that inquiry consider the number of people that have lost their lives while waiting for referral to treatment?
That inquiry is considering and has taken a wide range of evidence from all community groups, all user groups, from staff groups. We've engaged the Health and Social Care Alliance, who've been acting as an interface with the public. A huge amount of evidence has been gathered, and I know that David Strang and his colleagues are working on that at the moment, and the board is absolutely committed to implementing the outcomes of that review. And I think in parallel with that, what we've done is to put in place new clinical leadership for mental health services in Tayside. So Professor Keith Matthews, who I think commands a good degree of respect and confidence clinically, we've brought in a senior manager to support him, and we've got an experienced senior nurse in there, so that sort of triumvirate leading the redesign of mental health services across Tayside, that work is already in place, and a notion that we're going to really develop mental health services on a cross-Tayside basis. So I think that has been a step forward, and we're very much looking forward to the results of the review.
Thank you, Mr. Wright. And just a final question, because I know this will be relevant to local families in Tayside. What is the current status of the review? Very briefly, if you could outline what engagement you've had with local families and what the timetable is in terms of publishing the review and then implementation of the recommendations of that review.
David Strang came to the board in December and presented an update of the review. We've had a report from the Alliance, and Chairman, you might want to say a bit more about that.
Obviously, it's an independent review. David Strang has set out his plans for gathering evidence and then his plans for reviewing that evidence. So far, the update he gave us in December said they'd got the first lot of evidence from the service users and their families, the work that the allies had done. He's now capturing the evidence from the staff, and that's been led by the trade unions. He's doing a review on that. Some themes are starting to emerge, and they're not surprising what these themes are. They're about access, they're about waiting times. When he reviews the evidence in front of him, he will then come to us with proposals. I don't have an actual date when that is, because he's still considering the evidence, and he will be coming back to us in the next month or so with a clearer timescale for when it's going to report.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brown. Just a small supplementary on that. Malcolm Wright, you talked about having clinical leadership in place for mental health. When I visited CAMHS in the summer last year, of seven consultant posts, I think four to four and a half were full at that time. Clearly, the nuts and bolts you talk about are having doctors in place to take to see patients. Has that figure improved?
I don't have the most up-to-date figure in front of me, but I do know that one of the challenges we faced as a board is the ability to recruit consultant psychiatrists.
Yep.
And part of that is around the reputation of the service, about how well the board supports that service, and actually making this an attractive service that people want to come and work in. So I think with the clinical leadership in place, we're seeking to create an attractive environment for people to come. But I don't know if any
would
of my
you be able
can,
to come back to the committee in writing with the number of vacancies in CAMHS?
Yes.
If I could just comment, Mr. Wright, you said that the board's leadership team is taking this seriously now. It's one of the reasons that we are so upset about payments to the former chief executive, because these issues were raised time and time again by many politicians, especially mental health, and they were never taken that seriously. So these issues have got to be seen together. Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much. Good morning to everyone. I'd like to talk about internal audit within the board, and the internal audit function has featured at the committee on several occasions in the past. I'd like to firstly get your view at the moment of where we are with the internal audit process in NHS Tayside.
The internal audit in NHS Tayside is currently delivered by an organisation called FTF, who deliver internal audit services to a number of health boards, and they're actually hosted by NHS Fife. As you'll have seen from the governance paper, as part of my review of governance, I wanted an independent review of the effectiveness of our internal audit. So I commissioned the Institute of Internal Auditors to carry out their review. This is a standard review that they do across the public sector, and I think in the private sector there's some tweaks, but the same approach. Their report confirms that internal audit processes are very much fit for purpose, that our internal auditors have the right skills and experience, but the problem that's been in the past in internal audit has been the organisation's response to the audit findings. Now, to resolve that issue, the audit committee had commissioned a piece of work on what is the process for handling recommendations from internal audit, what's the process for ensuring that the executive team delivers audit recommendations within a reasonable timescale, and how we then be assured that that work has actually had the outcome that we're looking for. That's been approved by the audit committee and it's now in place. My view as the chair would be that we do have an effective internal audit function. And we now have that internal audit function having the right impact on the organisation.
There's a view expressed at the committee previously that perhaps internal audit should have been picking up on a number of these issues that the members have been raising over a period of time. Is that also your view? Have you looked at the scope and the role of the internal audit function to perhaps address that?
I think the evidence would suggest, or the evidence would actually show, the internal audit had picked up a number of these issues that have been a cause of concern in the financial management and the accounting within NHS Tayside. But internal audit's actions and recommendations hadn't been properly implemented, in some cases not implemented at all.
Well,
Why would that be?
I'm not in a position to answer that. That would be a question really we would have to ask of the previous leadership team.
I'm having a look while the discussion was taking place, convener, of the board's minutes from December, which includes 240-odd pages of material here. I'm surprised anybody gets any work done if the minutes are that's as substantial as that. But the chief internal auditor wasn't even at the board meeting that particular day. And it says here that the previous role of internal audit was purely about assessing risk, and that the role for the audit committee has now been extended to include assurance. This is 2019, you know, why on earth is it only now that we think the audit function should include an assurance role?
I think what they're talking about there is the function of the audit committee rather than internal auditors. And as part of the governance review that we did when the new leadership first came in, we looked at all the terms and conditions, standing instructions, terms of reference for all the committees, including the audit committee. And the audit committee wasn't an audit and risk committee. And we have changed that and brought that in. Risk has been managed across the NHS Tayside, the governance of risk by the subcommittees, but it wasn't brought together under the audit committee, and that's the change that we have introduced. And as you say, that is the modern way of ensuring you have governance around your internal audit function.
Okay.
I cannot speak for why it was like that.
Okay. NHS Tayside, it's roughly £900 million it spends a year. What kind of size is the internal audit function? And you talked about the skills there, Mr. Brown. Are there sufficient skills across the whole range of responsibilities that can give the board assurance that any issues like this that do crop up will be spotted and actioned in the future?
This was part of the Institute of Internal Auditors review, was looking at whether the internal audit team had the right skills, had the right resources available to carry out the function, and they have assured us that that is the case.
I mean, how many are there?
Refer that question to Alan Gray. I don't know, Alan, if you've got a figure for the number of the auditors in that team.
Including the chief internal auditor, there's 5 staff who work with part of that team.
Okay. And I've tried my best to find any mention of any audit discussion, material, recommendations, actions or otherwise. I'm only at page 70 so far of the 240 pages, but it doesn't seem to me that there's a focus, a primary focus on audit material, recommendations, actions and so on within this barrage of text that's in the minutes. Is that something that you would plan to change to give a greater priority and focus to the audit function?
Well, as I said, we have changed the terms of reference from the audit committee to audit and risk. And in addition to that, the chief executive has introduced a senior role to look at the risk management system across NHS Tayside. And how effectively that's being managed by the executives and how effective the governance is by the subcommittees, the audit committee and the main board. So we have increased the focus and increased the resource that we're actually putting into doing that. I mean, I think this question of governance, Mr. Neil mentioned it earlier and it was the point I was trying to get in on, is there has been a systematic failure of governance. And one of the challenges that we had to meet as new leadership team was changing that and fixing that. You know, and one of the reasons why it could be argued that as a chair I wasn't given the advice of what was in the 2006 circular was the board didn't have a discrete board secretary function, didn't have a discrete function where there was one individual who that's what they did for a living. As they looked after the board, they looked after the governance, and they provided that centre of excellence, that expertise and advice. We've now got that in place. I think you'll have seen that in the governance review to counter that particular systemic problem.
Just my last query on it, convener. How will we know, how will the public decide know and be assured that audit function and recommendations that may emerge from now on are given priority, are visual within the minutes of the the board and acted upon? Because you said, of course, that they were perhaps made some recommendations in the past that just weren't either seen or acted upon. How can you assure us that that will no longer be the case and these will be taken seriously?
There's two places where you'll see the evidence of that. Firstly, you'll see it in the audit committee, the audit and risk committee's minutes, where there's the action plan, where they review the outstanding audit recommendations and the progress towards them. And you'll see it again in the update that the chair of the audit and risk committee gives to the main board at the bi-monthly board meeting.
But that was always the case. That reporting mechanism was always there.
Well, it wasn't actually. Okay. It was there.
Where did it go then?
But it wasn't complete. There had been an approach where not all the outstanding audit recommendations actually were being followed up by the audit committee. There had been an approach which Mr. Wright and I discovered and went to the first audit committee meeting where the priority, what were described as the priority outstanding actions, were the ones that were considered by the committee, but not the totality. There had been an acceptance that there was a lack of capability and capacity in the organisation to deliver all the recommendations, so it become acceptable that recommendations were carried forward from one year to the next.
Very brief answer, please.
If issues arise that would mean that the audit committee or the internal audit team or whoever would wish to make the board aware of matters, serious or otherwise, is that happening now?
Yes.
Do you get sight of internal audit recommendations?
Yes.
And is there evidence that they are acted upon, because they weren't in the past?
Yes.
Okay. We've got that assurance.
Right. Thank
Good
you,
stuff. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Coffey. Bill Bowman.
Thank you. Just coming back to the corporate governance report that you have. And you talk about in the governance system the enablers of skill, experience and diversity. Do you now have the audit committee that you want, and do they have the right skills, experience and diversity, and what are they?
We do have an audit committee that has the right range of skills as far as the business of NHS Tayside goes. What we lack in membership in the audit committee at the moment is the financial experience. Is limited on it, because the resignations that we had, two of the members that resigned were experienced financial professionals. We are recruiting, and that's the specification within the recruitment, is for board members who would have that financial experience. We're not waiting to get that, because obviously the board and the audit and risk committee need to be assured about the effectiveness of the audit. So we have, as advisors, co-opted to the audit and risk committee two experienced audit chairs who are both chartered accountants and experienced finance directors in the public sector. So we have the audit chair from Greater Glasgow and Clyde and the audit chair from the Golden Jubilee acting as advisors and attending the audit committee meetings and also reviewing the papers. So they've committed 2 days a month to actually support Tayside's audit function, because we did recognise that with the resignations we had lost that particular experience.
If I can just interject a little bit, Bill Bowman, time is running on, so if we could keep answers as concise as possible, that would be helpful. Bill Bowman.
You say you're recruiting. Are you having any difficulty recruiting?
The recruitment process hasn't got to the point where the adverts have gone out, so I don't know whether we'll get a great response to it or a limited response to it.
You don't think that the circumstances of the history, as you mentioned in the recruiting consultants, will perhaps put people off?
It might do.
Do you have an action plan for that as well, as you said, for the consultants?
We have in our recruitment specified the skills that we want. The recruitment's not something that the board has responsibility for. The recruitment for board members is by the public appointments group in Scotland. So we don't really have the, control over the process. It's a process that applies to all public bodies in the manner of the process.
Malcolm, you can.
Yes, and I think one of the things is around the attractiveness of the board to come and want to be a non-executive, and certainly the message that we're trying to get out that this is a board that is on the road to recovery. And over the last 9 months, we've tackled some pretty fundamental issues in the running of the board, the governance of the board, the management of the board. The run rate on the overspend is now coming down, and we're getting that into a better place. We, you know, I'd like to report to the committee that we have repaid the £3.6 million through to endowments. So some of those long-standing issues we've actually got to the bottom of, and there are good prospects ahead of this board, and I think that makes it an attractive place to want to come and serve as a non-executive.
Finally then, on one Willie Coffey's points then, if we have these financial secondees on or temporary appointments, it would be helpful to see some of their comments coming through in the board papers, which we don't seem to be seeing just yet.
John Brown, Chair of the Board.
Yes.
Well, you'll take that away then.
Yes, don't take that away. I mean, the minutes reflect what happened at the meeting, so.
Okay, thank you very much. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Vera. Just to continue on the governance side, how many vacancies do you have on the board at the moment?
The board had 20 members. We have 20 members, but in the discussions that I had with the Cabinet Secretary when I was asked to come into NHS Tayside, one of the issues I wanted to address was the question of capacity, because in addition, obviously, to the having responsibility on the board and the board subcommittees, there's three integration joint boards in Tayside that the health board provides members to. So the Cabinet Secretary agreed to increase the size of the board by another two members, and it's those two additional posts that we're currently recruiting.
Now, comments we made already about the question of financial experience on the board, and you're trying to address that. But there was wider issues on diversity of skills on the board. Are you satisfied that the members you have now have a sufficient mix of skills to be able to carry out their functions adequately?
I do, yes. The recent recruits, the three new recruits that have come onto the board, two in December, one started in January, one of them has a very detailed background in the NHS. Another one of them has a very lot of experience in transformational change and managing organisations through change. The third new member has a long track record and experience in leadership through change as well. And that adds to the experience that we've currently got on the board, which I think is a good mix of people from the NHS, from other parts of the public sector, from the private sector, and from different aspects of organisations.
Now, you've now got 20 board members, and there's going to be 22 probably. Having the right structures and so on in place is very important. But how do you ensure that the board is functioning in an efficient way? Is there going to be an ongoing form of assessment or appraisal of board members? How are you going to do that?
Within NHS Scotland, we have always done a self-assessment around the boards. We're going to continue with that self-assessment. We have revised the self-assessment model, and there's a new self-assessment process coming into play next month across NHS Scotland, and Tayside will obviously be one of the boards involved in that. But we're also introducing an external assessment of boards to ensure that, I suppose, the self-assessment actually picks up on all the issues. We've developed a very clear picture or a blueprint of what good governance should look like. A lot of clarity now around the board's functions are, clarity around the resources that the board needs, but also clarity around the flows of information, clarity around what the audit requirement is, and clarity around the admin requirement. So that blueprint is actually being rolled out at the moment. I currently co-chair the NHS Scotland Steering Group for Corporate Governance with Christine McLaughlin, Scottish Government Finance Director.
Now, you presumably have an induction process for new members.
Yep.
Are you satisfied that that induction process is sufficiently robust that members are fully understanding of what their responsibilities are so that the self-appraisals, external appraisals can actually be useful?
Yes, the induction process is in two levels. One is there is a general induction that everyone receives, which is on the basis of who we are, what we do, what's expected of us. And then there's a customised induction for individuals, depending on what their background is. So each of them has an induction programme that runs. We also have four development sessions each year where we bring to the board any new areas in the legislation, any issues that we feel the board needs to be updated on. There is obviously training. All board members receive the on-board training that all public sector board members receive in Scotland. In addition to that, they also provide the audit committee members with specific training on their responsibilities that builds on what's in the on-board training. So they all go through that process as well.
Liz Smith.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Brown, would you accept that, given the very considerable difficulties that have been faced by NHS Tayside over recent months, and also some of the quite extraordinary revelations that have appeared this morning, that the public might find it very difficult to have confidence that the decision-making process within NHS Tayside about clinical matters, which is, you know, I represent the area for Mid-Scotland and Fife, and therefore a lot of my constituents are NHS Tayside patients, will feel uncomfortable about the decision-making process for their own treatments. Are you making any changes whatsoever to improve the transparency for patients about who makes decisions about what services are delivered in local communities?
The change programme that is looking at what services we deliver, how we deliver them, where we deliver them, is clinically led. So it's the clinicians who understand the patient's needs, understand the services they deliver, that are working to develop the first cut proposals, the first cut options. Now, these proposals and options will then go through the engagement process, where we are developing a process of engaging with the local communities to give a voice to the service users and the patients, and what services that they want, what services they would expect, where they would expect them. We have started that process by talking to, we've had a number of events with some of the groups that represent groups of patients, and we've taken them around to Tayside and had public events on that. As the work of the Clinical Alliance, which is a group of the clinicians that are leading the design of it, as that progresses, we will ratchet that up and be doing even more of that. The board at a development session on the 31st of January and the 1st of February is actually reviewing the progress to date with this redesign work, with the work on developing the capability and capacity to deliver the new design. And one of the clear sessions on that is the board are asking to get the updates on what the engagement strategy is and the plan is. I mean, that engagement will also include engagement with the elected representatives. And as you know, we meet around every 6 weeks with MSPs and MPs.
I understand from your perspective that these decisions and the investigations that you're taking at local level might be very clear to yourselves. I personally would maybe doubt that, but the patients and the people who come to our surgeries are very concerned across NHS Tayside at the moment that the reasons behind the decisions that are being made, particularly when some services are either being transferred somewhere or they're being cut, they don't understand the reasoning behind that. And what I'm interested in as somebody who represents these people is how that can be made clear to those people who are using NHS Tayside.
Ask Malcolm Wright to respond to that.
Yes, I think the process of engagement with the public, I think the process of making sure we're transparent about information and the challenges that we face, so the information that we communicate to the public, our openness and transparency of our board and our committee system, I think is really important. But I do think that the work of transforming Tayside and the public events that we've had, and I know you led one particular public event that I spoke at, I think all of these things are very helpful to really have an engagement with the population about the choices that NHS Tayside faces. I mean, the Auditor General has made the point about an expensive service model, and there are a series of strategic choices that the board and the government will need to make about the future of that. And I think we have given strong commitments about the future of Stracathro, about the future of Perth Royal Infirmary, and about the future of Nine Wells. So that transforming Tayside process with the integrated clinical strategy and with public involvement and about what we do where and the potential capital investment that would come in on the back of that, I think is really important. So to answer your question about the public, I think the public engagement and involvement is absolutely essential, and that's what we've been seeking to do.
May I finish with one question, Convener? After your time overseeing NHS Tayside, Mr. Wright, are you comfortable with the IGB structure in NHS Tayside, given that there are concerns that the transparency of decision-making between social care, health care, it's not clear to members of the public about how that IGB structure actually works. Are you comfortable having seen it in operation for your time?
I think we need to make improvements in how the IGBs are working.
Could you just say what they are?
And working with partners. And I think one of the things that I've set about doing, and I know Chairman has set about doing as well, is to build the strategic relationships between the board and the three local authorities. And certainly during my time in Tayside, I put considerable time and effort in working with the local authority chief executives and the two local authority chief exec and the health board chief executive with the integration board chief officer working together. And towards the end of my tenure in Tayside, the chairman and I hosted an event that brought together conveners from the council, locally elected representatives, IJB representatives and health board representatives to come together to say, how are we going to work together? And I know from a government perspective, there's a commitment by the Cabinet Secretary to increase the pace of integration. And I think that's very much dependent on the relationships and the joint working at the top of those organisations. So I think it's not necessarily the structure of the IGBs, but it's how IGBs work with the health board and with the local authorities and with local communities and with voluntary bodies. And I think that picture varies around the country from what I've been able to see. So there are opportunities for improvement here. And I must say, in my time in Tayside, I was warmly welcomed by the local authority chief executives and visits to local authorities, and I think local authorities have been really asking for the, you know, much improved strategic relationship. So just to finish, Convener, I think it really is a job, you know, for the board to make sure that we've got those strategic relationships in place and got strong partnership working. So the signing of the new agreement with Dundee University, I think, has been really good and very important. And I'd also want to pay tribute to the staff side and NHS Tayside and the leadership that they've given in all of the changes that we've gone through. So my conclusion at the end of my 9 months in Tayside is that I think we've done a lot to address some of the fundamental underlying systemic challenges facing the board and put in place and trying to get some of those things right. And I think the board is on the road to recovery.
Thank you very much indeed. Witnesses will also be aware that included in the Auditor General's report was the issue about the charity fund transfer. The committee hasn't pursued questioning on this today because you'll be aware Oscar are conducting their statutory report into this. And I think all these months later, this came to light in April last year, and it's now January in the following year, and we still don't have that report. I'm hoping to get it very soon, but we will review that report and decide how we scrutinise that. But can I thank witnesses very much indeed for your evidence this morning. I now close... I don't close the meeting. We're going to suspend for a couple of minutes to allow a change of over of witnesses. Thank you. Our second panel of witnesses to the meeting this morning, Paul Gray, Director General, Health and Social Care, Scottish Government, and Chief Executive of NHS Scotland, and Shirley Rogers, Director of Health, Workforce Leadership and Service Transformation of the Scottish Government. I would like to pick up on a number of points we have just heard from NHS Tayside. I don't know if you both managed to watch the evidence that we have just heard, but obviously we spent quite a while this morning scrutinising the enhanced payment, let's say, to the former chief executive. I don't know if you had a chance, Paul Gray, to watch that evidence. You can give us your thoughts on that.
I haven't. No, I didn't convene her because we were waiting outside rather than risk being delayed for here, so we came down early. So, no, I haven't heard the detail of the evidence. If there are points the committee wishes to raise, I'll be happy to respond to
that. So perhaps based on the Auditor General's report and what we have learned, we know that this committee has been very clear over many years, as you know, about golden handshakes and enhanced severance payments in the public sector, and said on the record many times when we were scrutinising the situation at NHS Tayside that we did not expect and did not want for this to happen again. But we have seen a contractual variation from 3 months pay in lieu of notice to 6 months. Do you think that was the right decision for the board to take?
I think that the board acted on the basis of the advice that it had, and I think it's probably right of me, convener, to put on the record that I think the payment that has eventually been made, the sum of money, is reasonable. How it was arrived at, the panel has rightly scrutinised, but the sum of money that was paid out, minus, let me just be clear, minus the pension enhancement, which was wrong, and I'm not going to just, you know, I'm not going to try and use other words, which has now been recovered. Had such a payment come forward to us at that level, based on the advice, based on the risks, that sum of money was reasonable.
There seemed from the evidence this morning, Mr. Gray, I'm not sure that the advice that was coming from the Central Legal Office was perhaps as strong or as clear as a health board might expect. Do you have confidence in the advice that your Central Legal Office is providing to boards?
I do. I think I would be very reluctant to base any opinion about the Central Legal Office on one issue, and also the advice of the Central Legal Office is to Tayside and not to the Scottish Government, and the committee will understand the basis on which advice is given to a client, and that client was NHS Tayside. Our task in this is to satisfy ourselves that there has been legal advice and that the proposals that are put to us are consistent with the legal advice that was provided.
Mr. Gray, I think it's interesting you describe the relationship between NHS Tayside and the Central Legal Office as lawyer and client, because certainly my understanding that Central Legal Office is a function of government and therefore has a responsibility also not just to their client, but to the public purse and the efficient spend of taxpayers' money. So should that consideration not always be in the mind of advice from the Central Legal Office? Because if it's not, then you might just advise boards that they might be as well to get private lawyers.
I believe that advice was consistent with the delivery of value for money to the public purse. The advice, as it was presented to us in the business case, led Tayside to conclude that the risks of not settling, so in other words, of going down some other route, would be likely to incur higher costs. And that was the point I was trying to make at the beginning about the sum of money being reasonable. I think also there were other risks which the Central Legal Office and Tayside would have wanted to take into account, the risk of not being able to employ a substantive chief executive, for example, if the process was long and drawn out. So I would expect the Central Legal Office to factor in value for money for the public purse, and indeed that is what Ms. Rogers and others are expected to do and did do in agreeing to sign off the settlement at the level, as I have said, minus now the pension payment. And I will also say to the committee, in the interest of transparency, I didn't know that when a settlement is made, a pension enhancements should or could not also be made. So I didn't know that either. That was new information to me, which came out through the audit. And I've said to Audit Scotland, and I shall again say it for the record here, I'm actually, despite the difficulties of this, I'm grateful to Audit Scotland for unearthing some of these points so that we can put them right, so that we can ensure that the public purse is not disadvantaged.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I'll stick on that point. I do understand the point you're making, Mr. Gray, about the board acts on the advice that it has, I think you said, and on that basis you consider it reasonable. Now, I have you at a slight disadvantage because I was obviously in the session this morning and I appreciate you haven't seen that, but if I might paraphrase some of the evidence that we heard, we explored the business case that ultimately was signed off on, and we heard from the Central Legal Office that it would appear that there was no real in-depth scrutiny of the potential claims that could have been raised by the departing chief executive. It appears that there may have been insertion of standard figures on possibility of success and possibility of bringing those claims in the first place, which I understand is something the CLO might use as a process anyway. And perhaps there was less than robust advice on the pensions point, just to isolate two or three. Now, given that the board and you and Dr. Ingram go with the advice that they've received, are you concerned about the response from the CLO this morning that I've just outlined to you? And what will you do as a result of that?
Well, the first thing, Mr. Kerr, the first thing I'll do is read the transcript, because I shall want to look at that. If you're indicating to me that this committee has concerns, then I will take that very seriously and I will read the transcript. And when I've done that, I'll consider what to do next.
Mr. Gray, can I interject here and just say, it's a little bit concerning that you saw the agenda for the committee today. We took evidence on this at length from 9 o'clock to 9:45, and it is broadcast, but we're not getting sufficient answers from you when that information was available to you to watch or to come into the committee.
Well, I apologise for that, Convener. That was my judgment, and as I say, we waited outside. We were here early and thought we would be taken at 10 o'clock. We therefore waited in the waiting area from 9:45 to 10. I can only apologise. Okay. That was my judgment.
You know you're welcome to join us in the public gallery at any point.
Thank you.
Liam Kerr.
And just taking it up a stage then, it seems that perhaps the business case may have been less than ideal when it was signed off, and that would suggest perhaps a failure at the CLO, perhaps a failure at the HR level. But what support does the Scottish Government give in this process? I mean, as Convener's pointed out, the Scottish Government is inherently bound up with what goes on in one of these terminations, one of these settlements. So where were you? Where was Shirley Rogers?
I'll bring Ms. Rogers in a moment. We are required to scrutinise the business case to satisfy ourselves that employer, in this case NHS Tayside, have taken legal advice and that the business case is based on the advice that they have taken. We did satisfy ourselves about that. We are required to satisfy ourselves about value for money, about reasonableness, as I've said to the convener. And we did that too. But I think I should say to the committee that Ms. Rogers and I have discussed this at some length, as you would expect. The fact of a board being at stage five on the ladder of escalation is very rare indeed. It happened in relation to Argyll and Clyde when that board was dissolved some considerable number of years ago. It happened in relation to Western Isles, again, some considerable number of years ago. And this is the first time in my tenure as Chief Executive that it has happened. And why I'm saying that is because we have, Ms. Rogers and I have concluded that were such an eventuality to happen again, we would take, or I would advise my successors to take, more direct control of any settlement arrangement so that, in addition to the assurances that the board sought and obtained and the material they provided us in the business case, given the circumstances are unique, complex, subject to public scrutiny and quite testing, you know, my reflection is, if I'm answering you very straightforwardly, we would do more next time. And if you say, does that mean you think you should have done more in this case, then the answer to that is inevitably yes. Mm-hmm. We did all that we believed we should do, but we have learned from this and we will do it differently in the future.
Shirley Rogers, your name was taken there, so do you want to respond to that?
I would support the comments that Mr. Gray has made. I would add to that that in terms of the Scottish Government role, we provide a model contract that we expect employers to use. Now, clearly that model contract has allowed for a degree of dubiety in respect of the notice period, and we are busy at the moment reviewing that model contract to make, I suppose, to make it less arbitrary for boards to decide whether or not which elements of it that they want to select. So you'll be aware already from the evidence that's been produced that the model contract gives the board leeway to determine whether it wants to go between 3 and 6 months' notice. Mm-hmm. Perhaps that leeway is a mistake. Perhaps we should just direct how much notice. So there's something that's working there. So and we provide the guidance around how a settlement is to be processed. So if I was looking at it from a systems perspective, we give guidance to boards about the kind of contract we would expect them to have in place. We do the kind of scrutiny that Mr. Gray's outlined, both in terms of the business case and the assurance that legal advice has been taken. And then we provide guidance around settlement. So in process terms, there is a considerable amount of hoops, if you like.
But you expect the legal advice to be, you take it as read, the legal advice will be sufficiently robust.
Inevitably.
And perhaps if I'm hearing you right, this process may raise questions about that assumption. Is that a fair conclusion to draw?
Well, you've raised questions about them, Mr. Kerr, and I'm not assuming I'm taking it that these are concerns of the committee, and therefore I'm going to follow them up.
I'm grateful. Thank you.
Alec Neil.
Paul, you rightly said you've learnt lessons from this, and I think one of the messages coming out of this morning's evidence is there are a number of systemic issues that need to be addressed. I mean, this is now water under the bridge. There's nothing we can do to change what happened at Tayside, but as you rightly say, we can learn the lessons. For example, one of the lessons, I think, is that apparently different treatment between senior managers and people further down the rung. You know, I've never heard of anyone further down the rung having their contract retrospectively changed, for example. That's one lesson. Another lesson is in relation to the CLO, some of the stuff that they said on sex and discrimination allegations. And another one was in terms of the advice and support provided to non-executive chairs, where in this case, Mr. Brown wasn't advised of a 2006 circular in relation to the contract and so on. Will you, and these were only three of the things, but it seems to me that there's a need for a fundamental review of the systemic lessons that need to be learned from this. I mean, you've mentioned one of them, which is to become more involved, maybe earlier in the process and take more control. But there are many other systemic lessons I think need to be learned. Will you carry out or commission a review of the systemic lessons that need to be learned in this case?
Well, the answer, of course, is yes, Mr. Neil. I mean, when this committee looks at something and raises concerns, I think I can say very safely that whatever faults I may have, not paying attention to parliamentary committees isn't one of them. So, yes, yeah. I mean, Mr. Kerr has raised concerns, the convener has raised concerns, you have raised concerns. I accept the legitimacy of these concerns, and I think it would be only right for us to follow them up properly. I think if time permits, and I'll be guided by the convener, there is something we can say perhaps to deal with one of the concerns about apparently different treatment of people at different levels in terms of things that we may do. But, Convener, I'm guided by you as to time available.
If you can try and keep it brief, Mr. Gray, that would be good.
Ms. Rogers can maybe give two or three examples and no more than that.
It's simply to make the point that as part of our overall processes and policies that apply to the whole of the NHS, when there is consideration of the termination of employment on the grounds of capability or anything else, there is always consideration given to whether or not there are alternative roles that might be fit. So that is not something that applies simply to certain senior people. It applies across the piece. It most regularly happens on the grounds of capability, and particularly if there's a health dynamic to that, where an individual is no longer able to fulfil a particular role, but rather than lose those skills in their entirety, we would look to see if there's an alternative role that can be done. So I wouldn't wish the committee to think that in the board considering alternatives, they were doing anything exceptional in that space. That is part of the process. I think they came to the right conclusion in these matters, that there wasn't a suitable alternative that would be appropriate in these particular circumstances. But I wouldn't want Mr. Neil or the committee to take the view that that was something that was exceptional only to this individual.
I think the case in that particular case, absolutely right, it can be done. I think the question is anybody monitoring if it is done to ensure that there is consistency? And I think that's the issue. And it might be that, you know, it's not just in terms of when a level five arises, it might be that more monitoring of these things is required on a regular basis by the Scottish Government without necessarily interfering, but just to make sure that there is fair treatment for all grades of workers in the National Health Service, you know, retrospectively changing the contract. I've never heard of that before in any public organisation. And I don't want to get back into that. We've been through that, you know, many times, but I think there's an issue there about proper guidance to all public organisations, and similarly support for non-executive directors, particularly chairs of boards and remuneration committees, when these people are surrounded by professional people and nobody advised in this case about the 2006 directorate. Now, Tayside have now, according to the evidence we heard this morning, set up a board secretariat, and that was probably the main reason why that information wasn't provided. But has every board got a board secretariat? I'd assumed every board does have that, but clearly in Tayside's case it didn't. It's those kind of lessons I think that need to be learned, and these are fairly quick, sharp lessons that can be learned and prevent this happening again.
Did you want them to respond to that question?
Yes,
I think I'll respond briefly and at more length if the committee wishes. My brief response is we will review all of the concerns raised by this committee once it reports, and we will respond to them.
Good.
Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Mira. Mr. Gray, the previous witnesses advised that the current authorised size of the board is 20, but that you've authorised an additional two members. What was the rationale for that?
One of the things we asked John Brown, the current chair, to do when he went in was to ensure that the board had the right skill mix and the right people on it. And one of his responses to that was to say that he felt that an additional two board members with particular skills would be of assistance. Given that we'd asked him to do it, and given that he had evidence to support what he said, we agreed to his proposals. So I should say we. I mean, it's ultimately a matter for ministers, but that was a reasonable request.
If you consider that the board of British Petroleum consists of 14 people, the board of British Telecom consists of 12 people, and the board of NHS Tayside consists of 22, does it seem a wee bit disproportionate? What are they all doing?
Well, for example, some of the members of all the territorial health boards will have duties in relation to the integration joint board, so they will have more than one function. There are subcommittees, as you know, Mr. Beattie, I'm certain, finance and performance. I mean, they may be called different, slightly different names in different boards. So there are a number of things that that board members are required to do. And I would also observe, without commenting either way, that the board of a public body and the board of a PLC are rather different in style and function. I'm not commenting as to what I think is right and wrong. That's not my point.
It just seems to me, you know, we've heard that we're struggling a little bit to get members of boards or the right mix of members of boards and so forth. But if you multiply this across Scotland, it's an awful lot of board members throughout all the different boards at a huge expense. Are we getting value for money? Are we getting the right people with the right skills and the right numbers? I mean, 22 is a lot of people for a board, for one NHS board.
Well, again, that's a point I would be happy to reflect on with ministers, but we're certainly making, I think, significant efforts, and I may have given evidence to this committee on this before, so I don't want to repeat it at too much length, but we're certainly making significant efforts to improve the way we recruit, first of all, board chairs, but also board members, to make sure that we don't simply, as has perhaps been the case in the distant past, use generic job descriptions and generic specifications, so that we're very clear that when we want someone to come in with finance skills, or we want someone to come in with workforce type skills, that's what we're recruiting for. So we're being a good deal more tailored in the specifications we put out. There's also a question which I think the Public Appointments Commissioner, the Commissioner for Ethical Standards and Public Life in Scotland, has commented on as to whether the type of role and the remuneration for the role attracts a sufficiently wide cohort of people to it. I can say more about that, but I don't want to go too far off Tayside at this stage.
Just continuing on Tayside, the previous panel I queried about ongoing assessment and appraisal, and we was assured that that process was in place. Is that so across the board now, or is it something particular to NHS Tayside that's been brought in?
No, we're very clear that we expect all board chairs to assess and appraise their board members regularly. There is a process for that, and when I assess and appraise the board chairs whom I see, I make sure that they are doing that. So we expect it to happen everywhere.
NHS Tayside said that apart from self-assessment, they were going to be having external assessment. How would that work, in your opinion, in terms of who would do it and so forth?
External assessment of board performance?
Board members.
Well, I don't know the precise detail of what Mr. Brown is proposing, but I do know that there are a number of organisations who specialise in governance, who have expertise in governance, and who are able to provide that kind of support.
Thank you very much. Bill Bowman.
Convener, just going back to the issue of the former chief executive and the departure and the negotiation of that, why would it be, given that it's propensity to have public interest and concern about it, why do you think nobody bothered to ask the Audit Scotland, you know, what their view was?
In terms of before the settlement was made, I don't know that that's something they would we would routinely do.
Well, this is not routine, of course.
This is not routine. I agree, Mr. Bowman. I will not speak for the Auditor General, who is here anyway and can speak for herself, but it is my understanding that the Audit Scotland would generally wish to review something once it's happened rather than prospectively. But I would be more than willing to discuss with Audit Scotland if, in these exceptional circumstances, there was a different approach we could take. As I have already said, I'm very willing to learn lessons from this.
Okay, we may ask that question. Can I just ask one other question? I asked in the previous session about the skills and experience of the audit committee, and we were told that they have two temporary members, I think, who bring financial skills to the committee meantime, but they are looking to recruit. And it referred to the government, the central process of that. And it was a little bit of, well, you know, I don't know exactly where we are on this. It's being dealt with by the central agency. Now, you've told us that there's a more directed and more specific approach to finding people. Can you tell us a little bit more about how that would work in the Tayside situation? We were concerned, or I was concerned, that the people may be put off a little bit by the history of what's happened at Tayside, the various scandals, and may not feel inclined to join the board.
I'm conscious of the convener's signals. There's probably quite a long answer to this, but would it be better if I wrote to you? I'm happy to give you a brief one now.
If you can give us a brief one and then follow up in writing, yeah, that would be helpful, Mr.
Sure.
Bray.
The shortest answer I can give you is this, that while the appointments process to board chair and member non-executive roles is overseen properly by the Commissioner for Ethical Standards and Public Life in Scotland, and therefore one does not go and tap people on the shoulder and say, would you like to do this and that, and everything will be fine. Nevertheless, the Commissioner expects us to draw these roles to the attention of people who might be suitable. They then have to go through the full process, which is overseen by the Commissioner, and to ensure that any individuals who might be suitable have the opportunity to explore with the chair or with other board members as appropriate what the role might involve. And my office, Colin Brown, who's the head of my office, will also provide guidance to people about how they might apply, how to go about it. No, we will not write their application for them. That's up to them. But we do all we can to facilitate that. I've also, in my time here, cut back the number of essential criteria to those which are actually essential, rather than... we can say
if
more.
If you do have more on that, Mr. Gray, that would be helpful to receive in writing. Yeah. Thank you very much. Anas Sarwar.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, Ms. Rogers and Mr. Gray. I asked a series of questions around performance standards in the earlier session. I'm not going to repeat them, but I just want to focus a single question on mental health services. Clearly, the performance is simply still not good enough in Tayside. The most recent figures around CAMHS being 39% of people seen in time, and that was November 18 figures. At a previous session, Mr. Gray, you committed to look at the numbers of people that had lost their lives while waiting for that referral to treatment. Has that work been done, and are you able to share those figures with the committee?
Mr. Sarwar, I apologise. I thought that I had written to you on that, and if I haven't, I apologise, and I will. I think that's the simplest answer that I can give you.
So sorry, I've had no communication on that, Mr. Gray. So if you could write to us on that, that'd be very helpful.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'm just seeking a bit of clarification on that letter. I'll do that, but I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey first.
Mr. Gray had asked about the internal audit process, function of the audit committee, internal audit programme and so on, in NHT side in the previous session, and I'd just like to ask you similar questions. Like, is the Scottish Government content to the internal audit function, audit committee, skills and membership, scope of audit is sufficient to carry out its duties and provide the assurance to the NHS Tayside board now?
Are you, just so that I'm clear, Mr. Coffey, there are some, centrally provided audit functions, and then there's the committee itself that would be the non-executive members. Are you asking about both or either?
Both.
Yeah. So, unfortunately, as I think the committee knows, Ms. McLaughlin isn't able to be here today because she's unwell. I know that she is looking at the centrally provided functions with some care, and I'd be happy to write to the committee about that. I think that what Mr. Brown has done in terms of the temporary membership of his audit committee is well judged and sensible, because he has brought in people with, who have, you might say, directly attributable experience in this area. So as to the committee, I think the steps he has taken so far are good and commendable. As to the centralised audit functions, I know that's being looked at, and I'm happy to provide further detail to the committee.
Okay, I was having a look at the NHST side minutes just as the meeting was taking place there, and it said quite clearly that the previous audit function of the committee, the audit committee, was purely focused on risk issues, risk management issues. And of course, it's a much broader scope for an organisation like NHST side to only look at the risk management process. It's perhaps a wee bit narrow in scope when you might consider that they might want to look at financial matters or materials, procurement, performance, all of that. So I was just wondering, is that a common picture that you'll see in the health boards where it just looks like risk, looks at risk management, or does the audit function, the internal audit function, look, have a broader scope?
I think, well, the first thing is, given that Mr Brown is also chair of Greater Glasgow and Clyde, I think you can take it that he's bringing his experience from other areas into that. And Mr Brown and his colleague Susan Walsh, who was non-executive director in Healthcare Improvement Scotland, did a governance review in Highland, which produced a blueprint, and the Cabinet Secretary has been clear that she expects that governance blueprint to be implemented across all health boards by the start of the new financial year. So there is some progress on that.
Okay, last query, convener. It was also, I think Mr Brown said in previous evidence that past audit recommendations just were not acted upon. And we've heard that story before at this committee, convener, with other areas in the public sector. How on earth do we improve this? It's a common message here. The audit team, internal audit function or committee or otherwise, making recommendations to the board and not being acted upon. How can we assure the public that that will no longer be the case?
Well, I think first of all, there has to be a clear expectation on boards that recommendations that are made to them, whether through the audit committee or any other system or process, so for example by Healthcare Improvement Scotland, to pick one other example, are followed up and acted on. And I think part of what the committee is saying to me today prompts me to think about how we might in future pursue annual reviews with the health boards in a way that would give both the Cabinet Secretary and the Accountable Officer assurance that that follow-up is being pursued.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr Gray, I've just had clarification. I think you did write to us on mental health. I understand that it was received by the committee last Friday. Members have not had sight of that letter yet, so that's due to the confusion. Mr Sarwar is particularly interested in pursuing a line of questioning on that. Clearly, mental health is a really important issue. I will allow him to do so in terms of what he has just seen, but not all members have had a chance to review this letter. And so it may be that when we come back to look at the scrutiny of Oscar, which we cannot do yet because we've not received Oscar's report, then we will reserve some time for this as well, because it is a very important issue and members should all be appraised of the information that you have provided. I'll let Anna Sarwar pursue what he wants to for the time being.
Thank you. Just to clarify from what I've just briefly read, Mr. Gray, that looks like an audit of the rejected referrals, and there's no stats given in terms of the number of people that lost their lives even in that rejected referral category. It doesn't actually answer the question around the number of people that have lost their lives while waiting for treatment, either that through a rejected referral or through the length of time that they're waiting for. So it doesn't really answer the question. So if you could look into that part specifically and come back, that would be greatly appreciated.
Okay, thank you.
Do members have any further questions for Paul Gray and Shirley Rogers? Oh, yes, I do. Mr. Coffey raised in his questioning with our first panel of witnesses this morning issue about board papers, length of board papers. Now, this is something that has concerned the committee, particularly concerns my staff who have to wade through these pages and pages. I think it concerns us all. 240 pages of papers to go to NHS Tayside in December. I don't think that's unusual, Paul Gray, for boards, but I think you gave us an assurance last time that boards would do something about this, make them more concise, more transparent. What's been done about that?
So I can give the committee an assurance that, in fact, the Cabinet Secretary raised that very point with the board chairs, at the recent meeting and made it very clear that her expectation too was that board papers would be clear, concise and accessible. So that has been escalated and raised with chairs direct.
Thank you. Willie Coffey.
Just on that, I was also looking at the minutes. There was 38 people at that meeting, which is roughly the same number of folk that's in this room. That's a kind of ridiculous number of people to be attending a board meeting. Surely there was 9 doctors, 3 professors, 3 councillors and a whole myriad of people. But who wasn't there? Was the chief internal auditor? I mean, that, come on. Let's get it sorted, get it right.
From John Brown and Malcolm Wright this morning about changes to governance. But all the Auditor General's report on health come to this committee, and it's something in terms of leadership and governance we will be keeping a close eye on. Can I thank you both very much indeed for your evidence this morning, and I'll close the public session of this meeting.